TV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
Good evening. My name is Doug Arnold, and I'm your host for tonight's rendition of Poet's Pause. On Poet's Pause, we read poetry, no surprise. We look to bring the best in both local and regional poetry to our TV studio and let the poets sally forth with their magnificent writings. I normally start the show, as I will tonight, with a reading the poem of a well-known national poet. In this case, it's a poem by Stephen Dobbins, and the title of the poem is "The Invitations Overhead." At the edge of a golf course, a man watches geese land on a pond, the bottom of which is spotted with white golf balls. It is October, and the geese pause in their long flight. Honking and flapping at one another, they seem to discuss their travels, and the man thinks how the world must look when viewed from above. Villages and cornfields, the autumn trees. The man wonders how his own house must look, seen from the sky, the grass he has cut 1,000 times, the border of white flowers, the house where he walks from room to room. His children gone, his wife with her own life, although he knows the geese's haunting are only crude warnings and greetings. The man also imagines they tell the histories of the people they travel over, their loneliness, the lives of those who can't change their places, who each year grow more isolated and desperate. Is this what quickens his breathing? When at night, the distant honking seems mixed with the light of distant stars. Follow us, they call, as if life could be made better by departure. Or if he were still young enough to think it so. That was "The Invitations Overhead" by Stephen Dobbins. Tonight, it's our pleasure to bring a well-known local regional poet. His name is Patrick Klimcho, and he will now delight you or frighten you with his poetry. Take it away, Patrick.
Well, I'm about ready to frighten myself. Because the primary elections this month, and in the past I've done a good bit of poetry parodies regarding politics. And these days it's hard. It's hard because people are they get so upset so easily. So I just want to preface this by saying, you know, I don't really hate you, you know, it's all good. But just have some fun with some parodies and we'll make some fun of politics. And I've been having a real hard time getting my head around this election, this whole primary process. It brought about this little thought. This is called incongruities. It's hard loving everyone while trusting no one, forgiving everything, forgetting nothing, planning for life eternal with death imminent, listening to everything, accepting nothing, or very little, only what is personally deemed to be true. Living by laws self-written and upholding those precepts scrupulously. For when For when one violates their own boundaries, they must deal with the incongruities. And I just think there's been a lot of incongruities in the news the last couple of months. And it's just a shame because it seems like there's so little communication between sides. You know, the art of compromise appears to be lost. And I brought up this poem, and a lot of these are older. Some of these are 5, 8, 10 years old. History lessons more than current events. This is called Koan. What is the sound of one hand clapping? Two podiums upon a stage, two figures facing, two sets of facts so-called that bypass each other, never meeting. As we hear what we choose to hear, see what we want to see, no meeting of minds or hearts, no wish to confer, no agreement possible. Thus the great silence falls amidst the babble, all movement ends. Despair is the sound of one hand clapping. There's been a lot of talk about building a wall across the Mexican border. One Democratic politician said that if Mr. Trump wins the election, they'll have to build a wall to keep people from fleeing to Mexico, but it's neither here nor there. But a lot of this, I mean, my people came over to this country within the last 70, 80 years. I think most of us did. And it just sort of upsets me that we take this kind of outlook on immigrants. And that brought about this retake of Emma Lazarus's poem on the Statue of Liberty. It's called Scrap Copper. Give me your tired, your poor. Paying for labor is something to deplore. Your huddled masses yearning to be free will work cheap when fleeing poverty. The wretched refuse of your teeming shore will do the jobs they say that we abhor. Send these, the homeless, tempest-tossed to me. We'll let them work illegally. I lift my lamp beside the golden door to light you as you mop my floor. Our own roots we somehow fail to see as we dismantle Lady Liberty. Just on a lighter note, I don't think, no matter what political party you belong to, I don't think anybody really enjoys paying taxes. So I did this little riff on Geoffrey Chaucer, since it's April, tax season, in fake Middle English. In Mirabrilla, one must sorely note that regal dooms swarm in fierced Prosota, and draineth every vein of swick moisture, the very blood which doth the life empower. On the IRS, ache with its rank breath, inspireth dread whilst sighing down my neck. Can I still deduct my younger son, for through my purse half their course he run? The smaller fool is mocking of such complexity that wakens all the nick to my sore-tried CPA. Striketh the realm so deeply and our courages than longen folk to sake for tax dodges. I had to throw that in. It's my wife's favorite poem that I did. And while we're on the subject of doing parodies of old English poets, I think a lot of the economic policies that are still decried today, I mean, listen to Bernie Sanders. And of course, back in 2000, 2007, 2008, when things were really crashing, it led me to do this little take on the soliloquy from Macbeth. To borrow and to borrow and to borrow binds them in this place from pay to pay, because they are only able to buy on time. And all these mortgages have blighted souls mired in crushing debt. Shout, shout such scandal. Payments start at first too low for borrowers, who then cry out in hopeless rage when they can pay no more. It is a trap set with an interest rate, accepted without inquiry, leaving them with nothing. I don't know what things have gotten all that much better in the years since. And of course, just the sheer recalcitrance of politicians. I mean, global warming, just refuse to believe it. And it just strikes me, this is called political science. The practice of science these days is relegated to the realm of politics, where proof of reality follows somewhat tenuous rules, easier to feel good about, less rigorous than those thorny facts to which the climatologists must adhere. Thus, liberals will not be allowed to dictate the course we follow with their elitist theories, which is all well and good, I suppose. I consider it as I bask in the February sun, my t-shirt damp with sweat. I don't know about you, but I do miss the days of George W. Bush. He was such great material. I mean, it's like every week you had something. And I've done two. I'm not going to read them all because they clack on forever. But this was a parody done of The Walrus and the Carpenter. And there's just a couple of stanzas in here I'd like to go over because I thought they turned out rather well. And it starts out, the Fed and the Treasury worked with all their might and did their very best to keep our billionaires all right. But the iron rule of policy, the middle class, did blight. It soon was shown abundantly the workers had been done. At the hands of business big, their pockets had been wrung. They have a tood, the magnates cried. Our praises should be sung. A plea was set before the court requesting a reply about the noble Bill of Rights as applied to you and I. But security must guide us now. Your rights we must deny. The cowboy and the CEO and their whole merry band crept in oh so quietly and gained the upper hand. If we act conservatively, we'll plunder what we can. A veteran came from Iraq. She sought a Senate seat to get us back upon the track. Her boots were clean and neat, but this was odd because, you know, she hadn't any feet. And then some others followed her, and then there were some more. They came at last, their vote to cast from an eternal combat tour. The Constitution they would save, prison policies deplore. The cowboy and the CEO talked on and on as though their policies were still bedrock, though their polls had sunk so low. For all the common citizens, their frustration now did show. The time has come, the cowboy said. They balk at many things. The wars and floods and deficits of presidents as kings.
Excuse me.
I'll think the sea is getting hot whenever pigs grow wings. Patriotism, the cowboy cried, is what we now must heed. It matters not how many kids must sweat and die and bleed. We cannot now give in to fear. Halliburton we must feed. But don't count on us, the cowboy sighed, turning a little green. Back when we were draftable, we never could be seen. NAM was fine for other folks, the CEO now said. I opted out because I could, but now I mourn your dead. We fan your fear and beat the drum to turn your blood to ice. The CEO wants you to know it's but a listening device. And as for the freedoms we expect, he'd end them in a trice. It's just too bad, the cowboy said. The plot is getting thick. The Constitution we tried to spurn, but cannot make it stick. The CEO replied, it could be worse. Remember, Tricky Dick. A sad tableau, the cowboy whined. They will not realize that on jobs and fear and environments, we'll surely compromise. Wrapping the flag about himself, he tried it on for size. Oh, people, said the CEO, it really has been fun. we shall soon be going home, leaving troubles all undone. Come November, we'll held out as you defeat us one by one. And then, of course, after a couple of years, they got right back in. We were talking before the program about the media and how it's almost a for-profit business now. It's not like a public service like when years ago when we were young. And I've got to admit, it always makes me seems a little weird to me that these people get on TV and can say anything that comes into their head with no proof or just a strange situation. So I decided to make fun of some of them. This is called Rush Among the Loons. The beck meanders through the glen, round about the red fern, then flows through the dampness of the fen until it finds its way to sea again. Along the way, the land is lush, though upon it seems to lay a hush. No errant breeze disturbs the rush, and ominous silence seems to crush. Until the light of day's high noon, that never seems to come too soon, releases an unmelodious tune, the cry of the bog-dwelling loon. In dark shadows I thought I saw, and it was the only conclusion I could draw, the wide gaping cavernous maw of a reed the genus Rush Limbaugh. This rush proclaims a knell of doom to each rank weed and foul mushroom. His dread o'er the land doth loom, seeking to consign all to the tomb. Whistling in the dark, this hollow reed attempts to deeply sow the seed of its hateful, timorous creed, so from our fear we won't be freed. When BCTV had its offices downtown, right across the street, there's a historical marker, and I always used to look at it when I used to come in before to host or to be on your program, Doug. And this is called Historical Marker. While crossing Penn before entering BCTV to read a poem, I stopped at the historical marker at the curb. It tells of the year 1893, I believe, when railroad workers protested an arbitrary cut in their wages. The National Guard was called out, and though the protesters were unarmed, opened fire. Everyone, not a railroad worker, thought this a proper thing to do and applauded the military officers. The railroad magnates got even richer. But men died for exercising their right of peaceful assembly, for exercising their right of free speech, for trying to protect their family's standard of living. Sometimes I wonder about people who believe government should be run like a business, amorally and for a profit, like the railroad magnates of old. Sometimes I wonder how tragedy can be confined to a 2-foot by 1-foot piece of blue painted steel. I wish I could sing. I can't.
Well, I can't either, so.
But this was, I got pretty fed up with the whole budget thing in the house. You know, I mean, paying these people to sit there and sit on their hands. So I took the old song Aquarius from the Broadway musical Hair way back in the 60s. And it goes like this. When the loons are sitting in the house, they're stupider than Atavars. So please just cancel all bets. These guys should sell used cars. A chasm's yawning on the edge of precarious. The edge of precarious. 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 Hypocrisy and cheap grandstanding, apathy, disgust resounding, as they play up our divisions while we watch on televisions, our country's dissipation midst endless vituperation, precarious, precarious. Well, we've got about 4 minutes left. Do you want to really delve into something long and
Well, actually, what do you want to talk? Yeah, there's a few things. But honestly, the time got away from me. It's much further mm-hmm. into the program than I realized. But one of the things I wanted to ask you was what other poets, either living or deceased, do you kind of admire or take as a measuring stick or emulate or any of those words?
Well, to me, poetry is not only a literary endeavor, it's a performance art. And I've got to admit, I have a great admiration for the people who, when they write a poem, you have to sing it in their voice. You know, whether it's, if you're reading a good translation of the Iliad or the Odyssey with the wine dark seas, or Edgar Allan Poe, who reaches up from the grave and grabs your ankle and you have to read that poem at his pace and his meter. I like the older stuff, you know that.
What do you consider the older stuff?
Oh, if they're alive, I really have to give it second thought.
All right.
But, you know, there's a lot of modern poets. In fact, a lot of the people we get, even locally, you know, my wife is absolutely in love with a man named Hiram Aluru, who's going to be giving a workshop up at the Pagoda. And a lot of the people that are going to be in the Burke's Bard programs for April being the poetry month, we have what they call Bard Fest, and there's going to be an event almost every day through the rest of the month. So there are folders all about town. I hope people get to see the very talented local people who are going to be putting on workshops, discussions, little poetry readings all through the month of April and into May, I believe.
Yeah. Well, I think we have about a minute left or so, so I guess I will try to gracefully exit before our time runs over the great cup of poetry.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for watching, everyone. And we're on air the second Wednesday of every month from 7 to 7:30. So please tune in each month, and hopefully we can bring you poetry that you find both intellectually challenging and aesthetically enjoyable.
And mildly anarchic.
And that too. how much time do we have? This is the hardest thing. I'm supposed to say goodbye now, so I guess I said it.
All right.
Goodbye, everyone, and thanks for watching.
Have a good evening.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.